Hello students, I am Professor Suresh Mane, working at Girijabhai Sial Institute of Technology in Karwar, Karnataka. So I thought we'll have a discussion on heat exchangers with focus on plate type heat exchangers, because in the subject heat transfer we study about heat exchangers. We see that parallel flow, counter flow, heat exchangers, and we find out the effectiveness of the heat exchangers by LMTD method as well as NTU method. But in real life, I had the opportunity to work with railways, and there I saw that they do not use shell and tube heat exchangers, which we are studying in our normal curriculum, but they use plate type heat exchangers. So I thought I'll share my views with you. You can see the sketch here, very beautiful it is given. This is a plate type heat exchanger. Okay. So we will see what is heat transfer, then what are heat exchangers, shell and tube heat exchanger, plate type heat exchanger, advantages and disadvantages of plate type heat exchangers. Heat transfer is a discipline of thermal engineering which concerns the generation, use, conversion of thermal energy, that is heat, between physical entities. Transfers is classified into various mechanisms such as thermal conduction, convection and radiation, and transfer of energy by phase changes. Engineers also consider the transfer of mass of different chemical species, either cold or hot, to achieve heat transfer. While these mechanisms have distinct characteristics, they often occur simultaneously in the same system. We basically study a heat transfer subject, so we have components like conduction, convection and radiation separately we study, but actually in real life they all happen simultaneously. But because the other two types of heat exchangers are having very low intensity, so we only go for pure conduction, pure convection or pure radiation. So the three modes are heat conduction, heat transfer through conduction, heat transfer through convection and heat transfer through radiation. The heat conduction is also called as diffusion. It is the direct microscopic exchange of kinetic energy of particles through the boundary between the two systems. Okay, this heat conduction means, suppose you have got a hot cup of tea and you keep a spoon, so that you will find that spoon becomes hot. Okay, this is a simple example of conduction. Because of that microscopic exchange of energy of the particles through the boundary between the two systems, the hot tea and the spoon becomes hot. Or else when you pour a hot tea into a stainless steel cup, the steel cup becomes hot. This is because of conduction. When an object is at a different temperature from the other body or its surroundings, the heat flows from that body to the surroundings to reach the same temperature, at which point they are in thermal equilibrium. So normally when the heat transfer will only take place when there is a temperature difference. Okay, like in electricity you have potential difference, voltage. So only when there is a potential difference there will be a transfer of electricity. Similarly, heat transfer will only take place when there is a difference in temperature between the system and the surrounding, and heat transfer will take place until the equilibrium is reached, that is both the system and surroundings are at same temperature. Like you keep a hot cup of tea and if you forget it and come back after say 1 hour or so, you will find that it has become cold. So there was heat transfer and now they have come to the thermal equilibrium. Similarly, there is a convection when a bulk flow of liquid carries heat along with the fluid. Okay, convection means it is like fluid heat transfer, whether it's liquid or gas. The flow of the fluid may be forced by external processes or sometimes by gravity, by buoyancy forces, when the thermal energy expands the fluid. Okay, in the case of fire plume, or you can see even your solar water heaters. So solar water heater, the heat transfer takes place because of buoyancy only. difference in temperatures. So difference when the temperature of water changes, the density changes, and density changes, there is a flow of natural flow. All convective processes also move heat partly by diffusion as well. Another form of convection is forced convection. In this case, the fluid is forced by flow of by use of pump, fan or other mechanical means. So normally when like your radiator and all, you might have seen car radiators. So car radiator, there is a pump. So the pump is taking out the engine hot water and sending it to the radiator under pressure. So this is known as forced convection. And even there is a radiator fan. So that radiator fan is forcing the fluid across the radiator. This is also forced heat transfer. But now we are sitting or standing somewhere. So here our body is also convecting heat, because body is at 37 degrees centigrade and the ambient temperature is on 35. So the 2 degrees centigrade difference, the body is giving away heat in the form of conduction. And here it is because of natural convection. There is no force. But when we apply, when we start a fan, then it comes under the forced convection. Then radiation, you know that sunlight comes from so sun to earth. It comes by radiation only. There is, it doesn't require any medium and all. And it is, goes through the photons, that is electromagnetic waves. It is transferred. So the three laws of heat transfer for conduction, convection and radiation are: first, conduction, it is a Fourier's law. Convection, the Newton's law of cooling. And for radiation, it is Stefan-Boltzmann law. So now we look at convection, that is Newton's law of cooling, which says Q, the rate of heat transfer, is equal to H into A into delta T. H is the convective heat transfer coefficient, A is the area, and dT is the temperature difference between the fluid and the surface. Okay, the fluid temperature and the surface temperature. And conduction, you know, Fourier's law, Q is equal to minus Ka dT by dx. And radiation, it is Stefan-Boltzmann law, Q is equal to sigma into A into absolute temperature raised to 4, where sigma is Stefan-Boltzmann constant. Now, let us look at shell and tube heat exchangers. Okay, you can see here now, this beautiful, I have taken it from YouTube and all somewhere. Here you can see the color difference is given here. So hot fluid is shown hot red color and cold fluid is shown in blue color. No? You can see that this is shell and tube. So the housing we can call it as shell, and tube means this, all this and inside whatever tubes are moving, they are called tubes. So this is a shell and tube heat exchanger, and you have got baffle plates. You can see vertical baffle plates to change the direction of flow. Okay, this is the old, age old initial heat exchangers, where shell and heat or tube heat exchangers. You can see the tubes, cross section of the tubes. You can see the tubes are given here, and shell also is you can see the shell also. Okay, so the tube means the one fluid goes in the tube and the other fluid is surrounding the tube. Now coming to plate type heat exchangers, here you can see these are the plates. These plates are very thin and the gap between the plates is also very small, I think less than 2 mm, 1.5 to around 1.5 mm. Okay, now in between these plates, see, in one plate alternately you will find red fluid, that is hot fluid, and the other is blue fluid, that is cold fluid. So here in plate type heat exchanger, you can see that there is alternate layers of hot and cold fluid. So now just by looking at this plate type heat exchanger as well as shell and tube type, you can make out that here the A, that is surface area, is increased. In the convective heat transfer coefficient, convection heat transfer, we have seen that Q is equal to H into A into delta T. I can't do anything delta T because the temperature of hot fluid and cold fluid is fixed. I cannot change that. But what has happened here, now I have increased the A, surface area between the contact of hot and cold fluid. So A is increased. So now because of this increase in A, the Q, that is the rate of heat transfer increases. Not only I increase the A, I also increase the H, that is convective heat transfer coefficient. We will see that in subsequent slides. Now coming to the point, here you can see the larger contact surface. These are one plate. This is one plate, you can see. So here you can see the plates are corrugated. The plates are not simple plates, but they are corrugated. So because of corrugation, like your roof sheets also, you might have seen all the roof sheets, they are corrugated, because corrugation adds to the strength. Okay, one thing, not only it adds to the strength, it also increases the turbulence. And thus I was telling that H increases, that is convective heat transfer coefficient, that also increases because of this corrugation. So to overall, to increase the Q, that is heat transfer through convection, I increase the H value as well as A. So this is how the plate type heat exchangers are far more efficient than shell and tube type heat exchangers. Now you can see a big heat exchanger. Okay, you can see how this is a marvel of engineering. Basically, I'll tell you. We will discuss about railways in coming slides. But I can tell you one thing: this heat exchangers, even in marine engineering, ships and all, lot of heat exchangers are used. In railways also, we are using shell and tube heat exchangers. So 1960s, when the locomotives, Alco locomotive came to India, that is American locomotive company, they had this shell and tube heat exchangers. But after this plate type heat exchangers came, we have removed all these shell and tube heat exchangers and replaced, retrofitted them with plate type heat exchangers. That is for lube oil coolers. Now you can see, this is slightly expanded view. You can see here, the red fluid is coming, that is hot fluid. And on the other side, opposite side, you are finding the blue fluid, that is a cold fluid. Now you can see alternately in the plates, one is filled with red hot fluid, another is the cold fluid. Here, this is the actually exploded view of a plate type heat exchanger. And as I told, the gap between the two is very small, I think 1.3 to 1.5 mm. A plate type heat exchanger is a type of heat exchanger which uses metal plates to transfer heat between two fluids, and has a major advantage over the conventional heat exchanger in that the fluids are exposed to a much larger surface area because the fluids are spread out over the plates. So as the fluids are spread out throughout the plate, the surface area is very high. This facilitates the transfer of heat and generally increases the speed of temperature change. Even the not only quantity of heat transfer is more, even the rate of heat transfer is more. They are now very common, and the small size are brazed ones, and the large size, they have got some gaskets. Okay, so you can find these are now found in the domestic heat exchangers, hot water for your geysers, and commercially also you have got lot of heat exchangers. So this heat exchanger was invented in 1923 by Mr. Richard Seligman, okay, and revolutionized the method of indirect heating and cooling of fluids. So here these are indirect because both the fluids are separate, they don't mix with each other, so they are indirect, also known as indirect heat transfer. The concept behind the heat exchanger is to use the pipes or other containment vessels to heat or cool one fluid by transferring heat between it and the other fluid. In most cases, the heat exchanger consists of coil pipe containing one fluid that passes through a chamber containing another fluid. So this coiled pipe is a pipe, and the chamber is called a shell. So shell and tube heat exchanger. The plate heat exchanger is a specialized design well suited for transferring heat between medium and low pressure fluids. So here actually the pressure, we don't deal with high pressure, we are dealing with high temperature but not high pressures. So that welded, semi-welded and brazed heat exchangers are used for heat exchange between high pressure fluids or where more compact product is required. Okay, this actually they save a lot of space also. Space in the sense, especially where space is a constraint, like locomotives, I don't have lot of space, so these occupy less space. The plates used in the plate and frame heat exchanger, it is also known as plate and frame heat exchanger, are obtained by one piece pressing of metal plates. These plates are actually pressed, one single sheet is pressed, and stainless steel is a common metal used because of its ability to withstand high temperatures, has got high strength and is corrosion resistance. So as we have seen in the diagram, it is made of stainless steel. The stainless steel also various grades are there. SS304, 306, okay. So various grades are there. The plates are often spaced by rubber sealing gaskets. You have seen that I told you the gap is very less. So to seal between the alternate plates, they have got a sealing gaskets. The plates are pressed to form troughs at right angles to the direction of the flow of the liquid, which runs through the channels in the heat exchangers. These troughs are managed so that they interlink between the plates, which form the channel with gaps of 1.3 to 1.5 mm between the plates. The plates are compressed together to a rigid frame to form an arrangement of parallel flow channels with alternating hot and cold fluids. The plates produce an extremely large surface area, which allows for the fastest possible transfer, and making each chamber thin ensures that the majority of the volume of liquid contacts the plate, again aiding exchange. The trough also creates and maintains a turbulent flow in the liquid to maximize the heat transfer in the exchanger. This troughs also create and maintain turbulent flow. So the H, that is convective heat transfer coefficient value, that increases. Okay. The high degree of turbulence can be obtained at low flow rates, and high heat transfer coefficient can then be achieved. As compared to shell and tube heat exchanger, the temperature approach in the plate heat exchanger can be as low as 1 degree. Just understand that approach can be 1 degree. The difference between the temperature between hot and cold fluid can be even 1 degree at the end. Whereas in shell and tube, it is almost 5 degrees. So you cannot have, when you send a cold fluid say at 30 degrees and hot fluid is coming at 80 degrees. So the hot fluid, when it is moving out, this cold fluid will gain temperature. Say it goes to 40-45 degrees temperature. The hot liquid will not come to 45, it will be around 50 degrees centigrade. So that 5 degrees, that is the approach. Whereas here it is only 1 degree. Okay. For the same amount of heat exchange, the size of plate heat exchanger is smaller because of the large heat transfer area afforded by the plates. So one more beauty is you can, it is a modular in nature, means you can add plates or remove plates. If you want enhanced size, you can add plates, and if you want reduced space, you can reduce the plates also. That option is available. So the corrugations also, there are two types, intermating and chevron corrugations. So you find that in general, greater heat transfer enhancement is produced by from chevrons for a given increase in pressure drop, and are more commonly used than intermating corrugations. So one thing is there, because the size gap between the plates is less, then there is a pressure drop. Okay, so to achieve the improvement in plate heat exchangers, two important factors, namely the amount of heat transfer and the pressure drop, has to be considered, such that the amount of heat transfer needs to be increased and the pressure drop needs to be decreased. In plate heat exchangers, due to the presence of corrugated plate, there is significant resistance to the flow of high friction loss. So because the gap is very low and it has got corrugations, to improve the value of H, what I was telling, but it also increases the friction loss. So when you are designing a heat exchanger, you have to consider both these factors. Normally this Reynolds number is for the flow. So because there is a pressure drop, there is a more pumping power is required. That energy is lost. Okay. So in India, I have seen this alpha level plate heat exchangers. So these are the variety. This is from their website what I have drawn. If you visit any dairy industry or even distillery, I visited this dairy industries at Belgaum, Dharwad and all. There I have seen they use this alpha level is a company, an Indian company, which produces this different types of plate heat exchangers. Like I was telling, brazed ones for small heat exchangers, then fusion bonded, then gasketed, then printed circuit, then welded spiral, then welded plate and block, then welded plate and frame, then welded plate and shell. So these are the various types of heat exchangers manufactured by Alpha Level. So this gasketed plate and frame heat exchangers provide efficient heat transfer and compact equipment with a small footprint. So this Alpha Level manufactures this plate type heat exchangers, which are flexible design and are easy to service and maintain. Basically, please understand that if the technology is good, then the maintenance also is low. Otherwise, now most of your people from coastal region, their relatives, friends are working in ships. So there also heat exchangers are used, IC engines are used, heat exchangers are used. So if it is having a reliable technology, then the maintenance aspects will be low. Otherwise, maintenance is a big issue and mechanical engineers are mostly involved in maintenance. So the product range is extremely wide and used in duties of for heating and cooling. Now I can give one example. I said that I visited dairy industries. So in dairy industry, I think you all drink this milk, pasteurized milk, na? Pasteurized milk it is called. Pasteurization means heating and cooling. So it is heated at around 75 degrees centigrade for few seconds only and then chilled to around 6 to 8 degrees centigrade. So this heating to that 75 degrees centigrade, we kills the bacteria. Even your cold drinks like fruit juices and all, what you packaged fruit juices you drink, na? Tetra pack and all in that. So they are all heated to kill the germs, then they are cooled so that the germs don't reproduce. So that is the idea. So that process is known as pasteurization for heat, for milk as well as even your cold drinks. So heating, cooling and heat recovery. Heat recovery means if any place you are burning fuel and it is used for some process. So the heat which is going out through the chimney, it is going waste. So we are paying money to buy the fuel, whatever fuel, solid fuel or liquid fuel or even gaseous fuel, burning it, and we can't send the heat to the atmosphere, na? So we try to extract the heat, maximum heat possible. That is known as heat recovery. Evaporation and condensation in industries. Evaporation and condensation, like in your AC. So there is something called evaporator, and which converts liquid to vapor, and there is a condenser which converts vapor into liquid. There is a phase change basically at same temperature, and there is only exchange of latent heat. Evaporation and condensation in HVAC, that is heating, ventilation and air conditioning. Then refrigeration, engine cooling, dairy and food to heavier processes like chemical processing, oil production and power generation. So they have got, wherever this heat transfer takes place, whether you have a evaporator or condenser in HVAC, refrigeration, engine cooling, dairy industry, food industry, chemical processing, oil production, even breweries. Okay. So this is application of the heat exchangers. This railway, I think you might have seen this locomotive. These are known as diesel electric locomotives. These were introduced in the year 1960 in the Indian Railways. Earlier, we had only coal-fired steam locomotives. In 1960, India had a tie-up with ALCO, that is American Locomotive Company. And this is a locomotive what you see. These are basically 2,400 horsepower locomotives. Then they are upgraded to 2,600, and now they are around 3,100 and 3,300. The same 16-cylinder engine, V type. These have been upgraded. We have now improved the turbo supercharger so that booster pressure is increased. Means we are supplying more air to the engine. Then similarly, we are adding more fuel. Instead of one helix, we are having double helix, so that more amount of fuel can be pumped. When we pump more amount of fuel at higher pressure and also supply more air, we can burn more amount of fuel, which generates more power. As I have told, from 2,400 horsepower, now it has come to 3,600. This is done by indigenous technology, by Indian people. But now the original heat exchanger was shell and two-type heat exchanger. So when it was increased to this, I told you that we had a design changes, like even the piston, it was aluminium piston. Now for this high temperature, high pressure, they put a steel crown on the piston. So that is steel cap pistons we had. Then and the turbo supercharger, which was earlier rotating at lower RPM, say 10 to 12,000 RPM, now it is rotating somewhere at 20,000 RPM and producing a pressure of almost 1.6 to 1.8 bar pressure. Earlier it was 1.2 bar pressure. So high amount of air is supplied into the engine. Similarly, the fuel injection, that has been increased. Quantity of fuel has been increased by having the double helix in the plunger of the fuel pump. So these similarly, a lot of changes have been made, but the heat exchanger was still that shell and tube type. Then lately, this Alpha Level and one more company, this company what I am showing, that came into the picture. So that improved the uptime of the locomotive. Uptime is this locomotives on an average, out of 24 hours, they are online for 22 hours. Only 2 hours on an average per day is taken for maintenance. Okay, so this uptime, this is only because of reliability. But whereas in steam locomotives, what I was telling, steam locomotives, out of 24 hours, only 14 hours, 16 hours they are online in service. But another 8 hours, one third was almost they were for maintenance only. So the maintenance aspect was very high. So you can see the Tranter. The company name is Tranter. They came out with this super changer, gasketed P and F heat exchanger, withstands temperature extreme vibrations. See here, not only temperature, vibrations, because the locomotive is on the move on the track, so it also has vibrations. And fatigue in railway lube oil cooler service. As I say, lube oil cooler. See, please understand this. Just we'll read and then I'll come to that. Indian Railways has the largest and busiest railroads, transporting around 2 crore people and 2 million tons of freight daily. Operates around 2 lakh freight cars, 50,000 coaches, and 8,000 locomotives. In this 8,000 locomotives, around half of them are diesel locomotives and half of them are electrical locomotives. Indian Railway also owns locomotive and coach manufacturing facilities like DLW at Varanasi and diesel loco modernization works at Patiala. DLW manufactures locomotive and DMW manufactures components, remanufactures traction motors and engine blocks, and upgrades the existing locomotives to the current railway standards and technology. As I told, that these locomotives, which were originally 2,400 horsepower locomotives, same 16-cylinder engine, they have been upgraded by DMW, that is Diesel Loco Modernization Works at Patiala in Punjab. Okay, they manufacture these components, the manufacturer remanufactures traction motors and engine blocks, and upgrades the locomotives to the current railway standards and technology. So, engine manufactured by DLW and DMW requires lube oil cooling by heat exchanger specified by the Indian Railway RDSO, that is Research, Designs and Standards Organization. Traditionally, the engines were fitted with shell and tube heat oil heat exchangers, whose substandard performance prompted RDSA to review alternatives. Okay, problems faced included oil overheating with increased fuel consumption and reduced power and damages to piston. Now, you please listen this. If the lube oil temperature increases, if the cooling efficiency is low, then the lube oil temperature increases. If the lube oil temperature increases, then what will happen? The viscosity of the oil will reduce and the friction will be more. And if friction is more, then the power will be reduced. And power is reduced to compensate for that, higher fuel consumption will be there. And it also leads to the damage to the piston. So here you can see the superchanger GX18, 105 plate units have been running for 10 years. In difficult railway, in railway we call PTLOC, plate type lube oil cooler. Okay, and they don't have any maintenance. You see this now. You can see these are the these end plate. You can see the blue color painted one, and this inside this is you have got that different plates. They are, which are mostly made of stainless steel, and they are all held together by this. You can see the rods. Okay. Now, even dismantling is very easy. You can remove these nuts at the end and it gets dismantled. And once it is dismantled, it can be cleaned by using wire brush, hot water and chemicals, and again assembled using new gaskets. Only thing, you have to replace the gaskets. Okay, this is the assembly. You can see 105 plates ka, which is used in railways. Okay, so very simple it is. Tranter. Now even Alpha Level has got this in India. One more thing, I wanted to tell ki railway engine, if it is producing 3600 horsepower here, so that is the power generated brake power. But similar amount of power, 3600, as you know, the thumb rule is one third of the power, fuel energy, whatever is supplied to the engine, one third goes to the power generation. So that is brake power. One third goes to the cooling water, that is another 3600, and one third will go to the exhaust. Okay, so this is almost 9000 means 10000 horsepower. The amount of fuel which is supplied is almost for 10000 horsepower. In that, only 3600 is getting converted into mechanical or brake power. Now in this 3600 or 4000 horsepower energy which is lost to the cooling water, in that at least we can consider 20% is going to the lube oil cooler also. So the lube oil is also working, removing almost 500 HP of heat. If you convert that into heat units, so that much amount of heat has to be rejected, and that is why that is a big amount. And now the space was less in the locomotive. I was telling the space is a constraint. So these heat exchangers are very efficient. They are occupying less space, and because they are gasketed with this polymers, so they can also withstand vibrations apart from high temperatures. Okay, so the advantages are these are very small, compact and efficient. They are very easy to dismantle. I have shown you the end. You have got nuts you can remove, and the rods you remove, and all the plates you can dismantle. And they have got corrugated plates, so they provide the turbulent flow and thus improve the value of convective heat transfer coefficient, that is H. And you can increase or decrease the size just by adding or removing the plates. Disadvantage is also, it is very expensive. Beginning only, it is very expensive. Initial cost is very expensive. Then even titanium plates can be used, and the gaskets, they are made of not ordinary rubber, natural rubber, but high quality rubbers like Viton and all, synthetic rubbers basically. And you need to have proper torque, because when you are tightening this, because the gap is very small, so proper torque wrench has to be used for tightening assembly and disassembly. Okay, so any questions are there, you can type the questions. I'll definitely answer the questions in the YouTube. Okay. I enjoyed making this video for you, and hope you also enjoyed. And Thank you very much for watching this and have a great time ahead. Best wishes.